Many thanks for staying on News Desk with me, Kwabna Chenche Henibot, into some more stories now. And the minority in Parliament will today seek to block the approval of Deputy Minister Designate for Local Government and Rural Development, John Oti Bless. Mr. Oti Bless is accused of making denigrating comments against the Chief Justice on a radio show. Now, the Nkwanta North MP is alleged to have described the Chief Justice as an agent of the NPP and unfit for the job. Now, it's a very long sound clip. We are just going to bring to you a bit of that. And we've had to edit portions of it to suit our editorial policy here. But let's just take a listen to that deputy minister designate making those comments about the judges in a bit. And then we're going to have a discussion on that in a short while.
Why? Meddling in the affairs of electoral commission. Now you was a whole CJ. Mami will love will be but when you're doing who are nananum, who are ma. No, to your politics, Supreme Court, no appointing general, your politics, no new politician, your canana, no ruling.
You have a CJ who, at her age with grandchildren and children, engages in politics. She appointed judges to the Supreme Court who are involved in politics, and she engages in shady deals with politicians. Are you not calling for war when you fictitiously rule against the Electoral Commission for the elections not to come off? We have to keep an eye on the CJ. There's a worker at the Supreme Court who is at loggerheads with her because of her partisanship. In an attempt last year to distract the lead counsel for President Mahama, they plotted to kidnap his child.
The lead counsel for President Mahama, Ayaton Elita. Omu kwa pamse, ombe kidnapping the ba. Ah, ombe using a driver. So ombe kidnapping Tony Lita and a ba. Send a baya ever taking attention of the issue. Send a baya on your table.
So that's John Oti Bless in that radio interview there. You heard him make those comments, and a few more we've had to edit out of this very sound clip. But let's now try and have a conversation around this, because we do know that there have been a series of petitions that have been sent to the Speaker of Parliament on this issue. There's also been a number of reactions on the floor of Parliament also on this very issue. But one of such persons who have petitioned the Speaker over this very matter is Richard Asante Eboah, who joins me now in studio with some more on this. Mr. Asante Eboah, good morning, many thanks for joining us.
Good morning, my brother.
So you've also petitioned the Speaker of Parliament. What is it that you want him to do for someone to get the nod to be in governance? Well, he has to take the House, not necessarily the Speaker.
I understand you, my brother. I would like to say good morning to your viewers. Indeed, for Asante Eboah, as an individual, my attitude has been that we need to protect our democracy. We need to put in measures that would help protect these young democracies of ours. So we ought not to encourage individuals who go about making comments that stands the chance of creating confusion in this. We realized that when it came to the Muntie saga, when I listened to the tape, I was quite dumbfounded, and I was quite surprised that people sit on air and make such comments. So I decided to petition the Supreme Court. So I went to Supreme Court to draw their attention to that. And subsequently, they were invited. You know what happened.
Yeah,
but on the same platform, these particular comments came from the Honorable Member of Parliament. And listen to a Member of Parliament spewing out such comments. Listen to a Member of Parliament making such serious allegations against the judiciary and the Lady Chief Justice. There's one thing that we need to understand and appreciate. These comments stand to undermine the authority of the court. It affects the sanctity of the court. This sort of conduct erodes the trust people have in the judiciary. And we ought not to entertain that. My petition to the Speaker of Parliament, for which I've also copied various individuals within the country, i.e. the chief justice has been given a copy, the Association of Magistrates and Judges have been given a copy, the Bar Association have been copied, former President Rawlings, former President Kufuor have been given a copy, the National House of Chiefs have been copied, the Inspector General of Police, and various individuals and reputable members of society, including the Chief Imam, Carlos Bushoff Conference, Christian Council Association. All these bodies and individuals have been copied, that they ought to add their voice. What I seek from the members of parliament, or the Right Honorable Speaker of Parliament, is that they ought not to go ahead to approve this Honorable Member of Parliament to become a Deputy Local Government Minister. You know why? Yeah. If they go ahead, it is a tacit endorsement or to be perceived or seen by the general public populace as an endorsement of the conduct or the pronouncement of the person. Already people are saying that because of his comment and his conduct on radio, that is why he's been rewarded to become a deputy minister. We ought not to entertain that. Beyond that, my brother, this particular sort of issues and radio commentary and the way and manner people go out there and make serious allegations and raise insults and insinuations on members of society, including institutions of the state. What it can do to our state, all ought to be very careful and watchful. My brother, you know what happened in Rwanda? Over 1 million individuals were killed as a result of conduct of certain radio personalities, politicians and radio hosts who sat on air and made serious allegations and called each other cockroaches and said they ought to be crushed and all that. We ought to prevent these particular things.
So we ought not to entertain that. Just a second. One would say, if this is your drive, then is it not misdirected? Rather, you should be focusing on the person who made the appointment. Why didn't you send a petition rather to the presidency?
You see, the president has made he nominated him already.
It remains a possibility. See, the president probably did not hear all these comments.
So if you think these comments are bad enough to suggest that there are three things that stand to happen in this whole debacle. One, I've already petitioned Speaker of Parliament that the Parliament ought to look at it. And I know already the minority in Parliament have added their voice to this call, that it doesn't seek to reason. And it will be a total spit in the face of the Chief Justice and the Judiciary if Parliament goes ahead to endorse the Honorable Member to become a Deputy Local Government Minister. What you also stand to do if Parliament do not heed to this and go ahead to approve him is that I will subsequently petition the President to withdraw his nomination. Then I will
After he's been given the approval.
If he's given
the
approval,
then what will be the point?
Say, no, the president ought to change him. Then I'll subsequently go to court in that particular regard.
But so you're going to sue the presidency?
No. This is what I'm going to do. If he's endorsed, I'll go to court and file contempt proceedings against him.
Against who?
Against the honorable
or himself?
The honorable member of parliament. I'm talking about John Oti Bless.
What for?
For the comment that he made against the judiciary.
Why don't you go ahead and do that now?
You see, there are processes. Do you understand that? And there are various ways. Well, one, if indeed Parliament drops him, I'm going to stop with that aspect of
the. It doesn't change the things he said.
It doesn't change it. But you see, there ought to be a form of punishment. There will be deterrence. There are people out there who know that tomorrow morning, given opportunity, if I go and sit on radio or TV and I make some of these unsubstantiated allegations, if I go to sit on radio or TV and try to undermine authorities of the state, the institution of state, if I go out there and get opportunity to stand on political platform, to go out there and drain insults and situations against possibly the president, maybe the opposition leader, Nanado Danko Akufo-Addo, or any member of society, there will be laws of the country that will be called to work. Do you understand that? Especially when it had to do with institutions of the state.
So you think the withdrawal of his nomination is enough punishment?
It should be enough punishment. Of course, people will know that if tomorrow I'm sitting on air and I'm a political officer, because one of the things that every serious politician want to do is that he want to be seen by the powers that be. So the person will be appreciated by giving nominations or appointments.
Okay.
Do you understand that?
I'll be taking some more thoughts on that in a short while. But let me now go on to the phone lines and speak to George Chebafo, who is a local governance expert. He's also joining in the conversation right now. Mr. Chebafo, good morning. Many thanks for joining us here on News Desk, sir.
Thanks for the opportunity.
So this is the call by one citizen of the land, and he believes this deputy minister designate is not deserving of the position. He should not be given the go-ahead to serve in the capacity as deputy local government minister. I mean, do you subscribe to this thought?
Well, thank you very much, and greetings to your cherished listeners. I think that, first of all, looking at the timing of the president's nominations of about three members for appointment as deputy ministers, I had reservations because we have barely 4 months to go to election. And I thought that looking at the challenges that the economy is facing now, for the president to do three key appointments at this time of the year, Something of
but these designations have over the past few months or so not had people occupy them. Does that not put a lot of stress on the ministers themselves?
Well, then the question then becomes why did the president not appoint them at the right time for them to deliver the appropriate service? It is not compulsory for every ministry to have two deputy ministers. One deputy minister could do. So maybe the president thought one minister was adequate. So 4 months to elections, I thought I had my reservations anyway. But at this moment, we are looking at so many issues. First of all, every citizen of Ghana who occupies a sensitive position must stand on high moral ground. Must have high moral tepidity, must uphold the best of integrity as befitting his status. For instance, if you look at, you listen to Honorable John Oti Bless. First of all, he's a member of parliament.
Right.
And for that matter, to stand on that platform to make those remarks that he is purported to have made, smacks of some concerns for everybody. Because apart from his nomination and subsequent appointment as minister, he's a member of parliament. And I think that he has sworn the oath of member of parliament and sworn the oath of secrecy. And as part of the oath, according to the second schedule of the Constitution of the Republic of Ghana, the oath of a member of parliament, you know, includes, you know, one's commitment to uphold, you know, the tenets and principles of the Constitution.
But how does a person's decision to express his opinions or thoughts on a particular issue suggest that person is not upholding the tenets of the Constitution?
Well, you see, I don't know whether you have listened to
Oh, I have. I have listened to it.
Uh-huh. So if you listen to it, I don't know the judgment that you pass on it.
I don't really have a take on it. All I'm saying is it's an opinion it was an opinion he was professing as to how relevant it was at the time and as to its prominence in things that are going on now. Well, that's another issue for another day. But point is, he expressed an opinion. So why should the person be punished for an opinion he expressed on radio?
Well, you could have an opinion, but maybe the mode of expression of one's opinion, you know, could also smack off, you know, an entirely different interpretation. Mm. You see, so especially when the person, you know, occupies a higher position in this country.
Well, would you agree with those who have the view that the president needs to withdraw the nomination?
Yes, I think that looking at the circumstances now, if the president holds on to his appointment, that would be better. Or if parliament, even sometimes it has happened before. Mm. We have witnessed a situation where somebody, you know, perhaps was not up with it with curriculum vitae, and for those reasons the parliament recommended for the withdrawal of his nomination for appointment. It has happened before. So at this stage, I think that leaders for parliament will have to advise the president to withdraw the nomination, because if he is appointed, you know, he would have challenges in terms of the acceptability and in terms of relating to other organs of state in the performance of his function.
Okay. Mr. Chebafo, many thanks for your time here on News Desk this morning. And George Chebafo is a local governance expert. He joined us on phone with some thoughts on that very issue. I still have here with me Richard Asante-Eboah, who will be wrapping up with us in a short while. So, quite a few people seem to agree with you to a large extent, but again, from what he's saying, the call or the push needs to be directed at the presidency.
Not necessarily. I mean, he says something. Mm. If the president can... Well, I know the president is privy to this now, as it stands now.
You know...
Of course. I mean, the president follow. If you have... If the presidency is quite a huge institution, so they have ways of picking all lot of opinion from among the society, the citizenry. So I'm sure now they are privy to this. Parliament has been petitioned. Parliament would draw the president's attention to that. But the point is, parliament can either, one, ask the president to withdraw, or parliament can refuse or will not go ahead to approve it. Those are the things that we need to look at. The other aspect that we need to understand is that It is not only a call by Richard Asantiyebo. I've heard a couple of individuals across the country speak. I've heard even people from the Christian community. I've heard people from the business community speak about the fact that how on earth will you appoint somebody who does not respect institutions of the state? Somebody who makes such serious allegations and rain insults and insinuations on Chief Justice and judiciary and Supreme Court judges. How do you appoint such a person in the midst of all these when such individuals who pass similar comments are serving jail sentences?
So finally, what would you say of the president and parliament should one, parliament fail to disapprove of his nomination, and two, should the president also refuse to withdraw the nomination?
I'll be extremely disappointed in the kind of democratic channel we need to pursue. I'll be very, very disappointed because, you see, we cannot build our country if we allow things go unpunished.
Okay, right. Many thanks for your time here on News Desk this morning. That's Richard Asantiyebo. He's a citizen of the country who has filed a petition at the Supreme Court. Well, he has actually presented a petition to the Speaker of Parliament, Doa Jaho. He thinks that very gentleman seeking to be the country's deputy local government minister should not be approved by the House. You're still watching News Desk here on your Joy News channel on Multi TV. Also available on your DSTV channel 421 and your Go TV channel 144. In a bit, we'll be talking about our drone praise. You do know it's happening this Friday. If you do not know, well, do stay on. I have some very great news for you in a bit. Stay with us.